Hello friends, let us continue our discussion on how to accurately represent the behavior of a material to an imposed material condition. So we began our discussion by considering what we now refer to as the engineering stress and the engineering strain. So we defined the engineering stress as the ratio of the load that we impose on a material to the original cross section of the material. And similarly, the engineering strain we refer to as the change in the longitudinal dimension of the material with respect to its original length. Now, for most crystalline materials, when we plot the behavior of the material and the load we impose on it in terms of the engineering stress and engineering strain, it will look something like this, the representative curve that depicts the behavior of the material in terms of the imposed loading condition would look like this. When you plot it in terms of the engineering stress and the engineering strain, it would look something like this. So this region, we categorize that as the elastic limit. So this would be the elastic limit. And beyond this point, whatever changes that happen in the material is rather permanent and irreversible. And we also saw the reason for this irreversibility is because from the atomistic point of view, the atoms move from one stable position to another stable position. So that being the case, when you want to move the atom from its new stable position to some other stable position, then you have to apply an additional load or increase the stress that is being imposed on the material. Meaning, there exists already a considerable amount of plastic strain within the material. And now when you want to increase this amount of plastic strain, or when you want to add to this amount of plastic strain, the material demands an additional imposition of stress, an additional stress the material demands. And that behavior, we call that as strain hardening. So even though we have not looked into what specifically causes the strain hardening, or we so far have not considered comprehensively what brings about the strain hardening, for this discussion, it is enough to understand that when you want to build or add to the existing plastic deformation, then the amount of stress that is required to add to the existing stress, it increases. And that is the reason why here, when you want, if you have a material that is already strained at epsilon E1, and when you want to increase the amount of strain to epsilon E2, then the amount of stress that is required is relatively higher. So you have to impose an additional amount of stress. And this behavior is referred to as the strain hardening, and it is a material behavior. Now, when we begin or when we plot the overall response of a material to an imposed mechanical condition, that is in terms of engineering stress and engineering strain, we have a maxima, a global maxima, which we refer to as the ultimate tensile strength. Now, it appears as though beyond this ultimate tensile strength, the material, instead of hardening with respect to strain, it begins to soften. So if you don't have any understanding, or if you don't have any knowledge, or if you have not observed the experiment visually, then based on your theoretical understanding, you would say beyond the ultimate tensile strength or beyond the maxima, the material begins to soften. And that's the reason why you see a gradually decreasing curve after the UTS. However, that is not the case. We have seen in the previous lecture that the reason for the decrease in the stress beyond the UTS is because we have another competing phenomenon called necking that is happening in the material. So, as opposed to strain hardening, which is implicitly a material behavior, beyond the UTS point, you have a geometrical change or a structural change in the sample, and that is the reason why you see a decrease in the curve. So we have seen during the introduction of the necking that necking is characterized by a decrease in the cross-sectional area. So this is what characterizes the necking. Now, when there is a decrease in the cross-sectional area, then the resistance offered by the material to deformation decreases correspondingly, because the number of atoms that would like to impose the resistance would also vary, and therefore you have the necking offering a little, or the necking offering a rather relatively low amount of resistance to that of the original condition. So the necked region, the region with the low cross section, would offer less amount of resistance when compared to a thicker region, and that is the reason why you have subsequently lower stresses to bring about the same amount of strain. Since this understanding is only possible when you physically observe how the material behave or how the geometry of the material changes, this representation we saw in the previous lecture is rather ambiguous. It gives the viewer, or the one who reads this particular work, or one who reads this graph, the reader, to make their own choices, or it depends on the understanding of the reader. So such depiction is not a very rather an accurate depiction. So we want to get rid of this particular property of, or the particular influence of, the geometry of the material on the behavior. So in the previous lecture, the reason why we introduce stress is because we want to get rid of the dimensions, or the influence of the dimension in the way we present our results. We want to get rid of the role of the dimension in the way we discuss the behavior and also the condition we impose on the material, and that's the reason why we got rid of the area, and that's the way we arrived at defining the stress. Now what we want to do is we want to get rid of the influence of the change in the cross-sectional area on the behavior of the materials. So one thing is for sure is that the phenomena of strain hardening, that is the requirement of an additional stress to add to the existing strain, doesn't change because the phenomena that undergirds it, that is you are shifting the atom from one equilibrium position to another equilibrium position, one stable position to another stable position. You are not in any case talking about any metastable position, you are not talking about any positions that is easy for the atoms to bring back to its original state. We are not talking about any such positions. We are talking exclusively in terms of moving an atom from one stable spot to another stable spot. And to further add to it, if you want to further add to its plastic deformation, then all you are doing is you are again moving the atom from one stable spot to another stable spot. So all this would cause an additional stress. In no case this was going to change. If we define, as we have defined plastic deformation, when plastic deformation is a permanent and irreversible change, and this demands atoms occupying a stable position, then all through the plastic deformation, that is from here to here, so from this region to begin with the elastic point, and till its failures, till the material fails, all of the deformation is the plastic deformation. And since the plastic deformation, the characteristic description of a plastic deformation is the migration of atoms from one stable position to another stable position, it demands an increase in the stress in order to bring about this change. In order to add to the strain, it demands an increase in stress. And whatever contradicting or counterintuitive representation you see in this curve, this counterintuitive representation here that you see in this curve, that is beyond UTS, there is a decrease in the strain to bring about the plastic deformation. This is exclusively because of this factor, of this phenomena of necking. And this phenomena of necking is not something that has happened within the material. It is not something that you can observe in the atoms. It is happening purely in the structure or the geometry of the material. So we have to get rid of this influence of the geometry or the size of the sample on the this particular behavior of the material. And to achieve that, what we do is we now, instead of defining the stress as the ratio of load and the original cross-sectional area, now we define stress as the ratio of the load at a given point to the cross-sectional area at that point. So you are applying a load, say here you are applying a load, so this point after the UTS, so I don't know, maybe I'll use, say again, red, so not red, maybe yellow, so at this point it's not visible, so maybe blue. So at this point after the UTS, you are applying a load, and the stress, engineering stress, when you want to calculate the engineering stress at this point, then it would be the load, say this point is after UTS, and let us assume that to be P1, and this point, the engineering stress at this point would be P1 by A0. So A0 is the original cross section of the material. And now what we want to do is we want to describe our stress in such a way that this load at a given point is not related to the original cross sectional area, but the cross sectional area at that moment. So in that case, if you want to calculate the stress according to our new definition, then it would be P1 by A. So this A here is the cross sectional area at that moment. So what essentially we are doing is we are replacing the denominator from A0 to A. A0 is the original cross sectional area, and A is the cross sectional area at that moment when the load is applied. Now, since this point is after UTS, the A is less than A0, and that means when you compare sigma e, that is the engineering strain, with respect to the new strain or new this is the engineering stress rather, when you compare this engineering stress with the new stress that we have defined, let us assume all it is referred to as the true stress, then this true stress will be rather greater, because the denominator of the true stress is less than that of the denominator of the engineering stress. And because of this relation, what you end up having is there is a shift in this point towards in the upward direction. So there is a shift in this point in the upward direction because the denominator which we use to calculate the true stress is less than that of the denominator that we use to calculate the engineering stress. And that denominator is nothing but in the engineering stress is the original cross section area, and in the true stress is the cross section area at that moment when you are applying the load. Now when we progressively, as in this section after the UTS, since the cross sectional area keeps on decreasing and ultimately it leads to the failure of the material, that means the amount of stress or the true stress keeps on increasing, because essentially the cross sectional area, which is the denominator, keeps on decreasing. So if we replot the engineering stress strain curve, this is the engineering stress and the engineering strain, we have the plot like this. And now after this point, let me draw it in a more, so after this point here we saw the area begins to decrease, and now we defined our true stress as the ratio of the load with the instantaneous area that is decreasing beyond this UTS. Beyond this point the area is decreasing, and this area is at the denominator of the description. And now because there is a continual decrease in the area, and this correspondingly there will be an increase in the true stress, and on top of it, since we also have the material behavior called strain hardening, this will also add to the increase in the stress that is required to bring about this strain. So when we do that, this point here begins to increase. So this point, these points which were calculated based on A0, and that's the reason why you see there is a dip in this curve, and now we are replacing the A0 with A, and since A0 is greater than A and these occupy the denominators of our description, by replacing this, just by replacing this, we can see there is a change, or there is a true stress is greater than that of engineering stress just by replacing the area. And on top of it, you have the description or the behavior of the strain hardening, and these combination would lift these points upward, and ultimately your true stress strain curve would look like something like this. So the true stress strain curve, the red line here is nothing but you are plotting the true stress here, and you will see what true strain is, and we are plotting true strain here. And when you do that, there is not you don't see this the trend that you observe in the engineering stress strain curve. That is, after UTS, you see there is a decrease in the, or there is a monotonic decrease in the curve, and that you don't see here. Pardon me, this should begin with the point UTS. So yeah, this region you can ignore. Yeah, those are just this just a schematics. So I hope you are able to understand. So whatever characteristic behavior you see after UTS in this engineering stress strain curve is lost. And in case of true stress strain curve, that is not, you don't see a dip in the curve, but the curve is monotonically increasing. So ultimately, this region here, the dipping region here, or the decreasing region in the engineering stress strain curve, is replaced by an increasing section in the true stress strain curve. I'm talking purely as a trend. So I'm not talking about specific, will the values be same? I'm not talking about all those things. I'm talking in terms of the trend. This is just a schematics. What we observe is, when you look, or when you compare the engineering stress strain to the true stress strain, the before or UTS, the overall trend would looks like more or less the same in both engineering stress strain curve and the true stress strain curve. Before the ultimate tensile strength point, or the point of the maxima, both these curves will have similar trend. They have a similar fashion. However, beyond the UTS, what you would observe is, in case of engineering stress strain curve, there is a decrease, or there is a dip in the curve. However, in case of true stress strain curve, there is no such dip. The curve keeps on increasing until the material fails. So the way we would define, the way we have defined the true stress is the load per area, and that area is instantaneous area. So this is instantaneous area, or the area when you are applying the load P. So this area, of course, is varying, and we are calculating that varying area. When we talked about the engineering stress, the area that we use is the original cross-sectional area, and that is a constant, but this is a variable. This varies with the as the testing proceeds or progresses. This area that we use for calculating true stress also varies, and when you compensate for this varying area, or when you include this aspect of varying area in our stress strain behavior, then you end up having the true stress strain curve. You are able to recover the material behavior of strain hardening. You are able to show that strain hardening is not a phenomena that is confined to or within the ultimate tensile strength. This is a phenomena that is observed all through the testing process, or all through the mechanical condition that you impose. This is something that is physical, and this we were able to capture it by replacing the engineering stress and strain with the true stress and strain curve. So far, we have only seen the description of the true stress. We have not looked into the description of true strain. Now, the description of the true stress, what we do is we replace the denominator with an instantaneous value. We replace the original value, which is a constant, with the instantaneous value. So you can fairly guess what would be the corresponding or the consistent description of the true strain. So we replace this A naught with A, which is the A naught is the original cross section area. It is a constant. It appears at the beginning of the test, and it's a constant. And we replaced it with an area that is varying during all through or during the tensile testing, particularly after the UTS. Now a similar description would be, so let us begin by considering the description of engineering strain, which would be DL by L naught. So similar to the engineering stress, wherein the denominator is the original cross-sectional area, in engineering strain, the denominator is the original length. So this is again the original length. So this is again a constant. So even though the overall, all through the tensile testing process, the material exhibits a change in the longitudinal dimension, all those changes are captured here. We don't consider the instantaneous length of the material at the denominator. We consider the original length of the material at the denominator. Now, if I sum up all the smaller changes, in the length with respect to the given L naught. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to sum up all the smaller changes. So if you could recollect the basics of integration, integration is nothing but summing up. So I'm summing up all the smallest changes in the length between the new length L and the original length L naught with respect to the original length L naught. So instead of if I don't know what my L is at a given point, so I don't know what the length of a material is at a given point, all that I know is the small amount of changes that the material has exhibited for the different stress. So those small amount of changes or the longitudinal changes that the material has exhibited, I have that for different stresses. The small amount of changes, that is dl, I have those value. Now when I sum up all those, then I will get the entire change in the dimension of the material. I hope you are able to understand that. This is nothing but the basic concept behind the integration. So I don't know what the actual length of the material is at a given point, but I know what are the small changes that add up to this change or this new dimension of this material. So for that I can integrate between L naught to L the small amount of changes. So between L naught to L, to bring the material from L naught to L, to increase the dimension of the material from L naught to L, the material has gone through a series of small change in the dimension. Now by integrating it, I'm adding all those small changes to the dimension. Now so let us assume for the sake of argument this dl is small l, to get rid of any confusion in the discussion. So this dl is small l, so maybe let me write it down again. So l naught by l, so 1 by l naught and dl. So the l naught here is a constant, so you can take that out and you can still have this integration dl either a small l. Now this is nothing but this is dl, so you can write that as the integration of dl with respect to integrating just the dl would end up you will end up having l in the range between l and l naught, and ultimately you would end up with your classical description of the engineering strain, which is nothing but l minus l naught by l naught. So this is nothing but your classical description of your engineering strain. So you arrived at this by integrating or summing up the small pieces of the strain or small pieces of the change in the length between L naught and L. To put it simply, you have added up the small pieces of change in the length that has led to the change in the dimension from L to L naught, and by adding all those up or integrating that within the limits of L and L naught, you have now ended up with the expression or the conventional expression for engineering strain. Now the way we want to describe the strain consistent to the true stress is we want to replace L naught with L. Now the engineering stress or the true stress we defined as load by the instantaneous area, and to make our description consistent or to have a representation that is consistent with the engineering or the true stress, we want to define a true strain, and that true strain would rather be, we will replacing the A, like how we replaced A naught with A, we will be replacing then the L naught with L. So the true strain, we will be replacing the L naught with L, so the denominator will be L, and similarly on the numerator you will still have the dl here. So what essentially we are doing is we are normalizing the change in the dimension with respect not to the original cross section area but with respect to the instantaneous cross section area, or rather with not respect to the original length but the instantaneous length of the material. So like we replace the original cross section area with the instantaneous cross sectional area in the true stress, we do the same for the true strain, replacing the original length to the instantaneous length. Now once we do that, and now we want to arrive at an expression for at an expression similar to this for the true strain. So we want to arrive at an expression similar to this for the true strain. This is for engineering strain, and we want to arrive at a similar expression for true strain. So we take up the same process, we integrate it between L naught and L, this dl here and L. Now it is important to note that this L is a variable, so this is not a constant, meaning when we talked about the original dimension, longitudinal dimension of the sample, which we considered for the engineering strain, it is a constant, it will not change. However, the instantaneous length, it changes with the stress that you impose on the material, and therefore it is not a constant. You cannot take that out here, but it is a variable, so it has to be within the integrand. So here it is L minus L naught, or the integration is between L naught and L. Now when you integrate this term here, it will be ln of L between L and L naught. So it's just fundamental integration, it's just it's 1 by L, and when you integrate it, it will be ln of L, and it is between the limit L and L naught. And when you substitute the limits, it will be ln L minus ln L naught. And ultimately the description of the true strain is nothing but ln L by L naught. So this is the description of the true strain. And here we have the logarithmic or exponential logarithmic term with respect to E, the long term with respect to E, and the ratio of L by L naught. And this is because we have considered in the denominator not a constant but a variable. And since we have considered a variable, we cannot take that out of the integrand as we have done for the engineering stress or calculation of the engineering strain. And that's the reason why you end up with such an expression for the true strain. Now, because of this expression, the true strain is also referred to as the logarithmic strain. The other name for the true strain is also the logarithmic strain, and this is because of the expressions that you end up with. And the reason why we end up with this expression is because now we are considering not the original in linear dimension of the material or original longitudinal dimension of the material, but rather the varying or the instantaneous length of the material. And that means you cannot take that out of the integrand, and you have to have that in between in the integrand. And when you integrate it with the length within the integrand, within the limits of L naught and L, you will end up with an expression like this. And this is the expression for true strain, and it is referred to as the logarithmic strain. Now, what we are essentially doing in plastic deformation, if we've been saying this quite a lot, that is we are shifting the atomic position to equilibrium position. We are not considering any metastable spots between the or metastable position of the atom. We are talking in terms of the positions that are equilibrium. So when you view or when you talk from that perspective, it is generally assumed that the plastic deformation conserves the volume, meaning whenever there is a plastic deformation in the material, there is not much or significant change in the volume of the material. So this is a conventional assumption people have when they treat the plastic deformation. Now in the elastic deformation, we saw that it is possible for the material to change in the volume when the material is or when you impose a load within the elastic limit, or when the material is deforming elastically, there is a possibility of change in the volume, because we don't assume the atoms occupying the stable positions in the elastic cases. However, in the plastic cases, or in the general plastic cases, when you talk about the plastic behavior of a material, generally it is defined as the movement of the atoms from one stable position to another stable position. You are not talking about in terms of any metastable positions. Then that being the case, in that case it is reasonably assumed that for a simpler treatments, not for a really complicated treatments, for a simpler treatment, for a general case, to bring about the general expression for the true stresses and true strains, it is assumed that the overall volume of the material is conserved during the plastic deformation. Again, this is because we are talking about atoms occupying stable positions. Particularly when you talk about the crystalline arrangement of the atoms or the crystalline structures, you have atoms occupying definite positions. And during the plastic deformation, since the atom continues to occupy similar positions, maybe not the exact position but similar positions, it is assumed that, or is reasonably assumed that, or such assumption at least for general treatment is allowed, meaning the volume is preserved or conserved during the plastic deformation. So the volume of the material generally do not change during plastic deformation. So that means dV is equal to zero. That is, the change in the volume is equal to zero. We can make the same argument for elastic case and justify why we can allow for a change in the volume in the elastic case, because in elastic cases we don't talk about the stable positions of the atoms. In that case, the metastable position of the atoms is allowed, it's permitted. Unlike the plastic deformation, in elastic deformation the metastable position is permitted, because once you unload it, the atom will go back to its original position. But since in the plastic cases we are exclusively concerned with the atoms occupying the specific spots or occupying the stable spots, it is generally allowed, it's permitted to have such an assumption. When you have such an assumption, and when we want to talk about cylinders, then the original volume, that is the product of A naught and L naught. So the volume of a cylinder is its cross-sectional area and its length. So A naught and L naught is equal to the area, be it after necking, before necking, whatever be the area, once the material has begin to plastically deform, and once there is a plastic deformation in the material, this area and the corresponding length of the material is equal to the product of the original cross-sectional area and the original length. This is this expression we arrive at, or we, it is reasonable for us to consider this expression, because we assume that the overall change in the volume during the plastic deformation is zero, and that allows for this relation, that is the product of the cross-sectional area and the original length is equal to product of the instantaneous cross-sectional area and the corresponding length. Now when you bring or rearrange these terms, you would end up having L by L naught is equal to A naught by A. So L by L naught is equal to A naught by A. This term L by L naught is often referred to as the extension ratio. So what we are essentially doing is we are rearranging the expression that we get based on the conservation of volume during plastic deformation. We assume that the volume is conserved during plastic deformation. It is a reasonable assumption, at least for a general case. And based on that, we relate the cross-sectional area, or the original cross-sectional area and the original length, to the instantaneous cross-sectional area and its length. And we are now able to arrive at an expression for the extension ratio, which is often referred by the term lambda. Now this is nothing but the instantaneous length, or the ratio between the instantaneous length and the original length, and in terms of the area it gets reversed, because the products are equal, not the ratios. So now using this expression, let us try to relate the true stress and the engineering stress, and true strain and the engineering strain. Now we defined, or we arrived at an expression for true strain as ln of L by L naught. This is the expression we arrived at for the true strain. Now you can directly replace this L by L naught, which is the extension ratio, as ln of lambda. This is something that you can directly do from this expression here. But however, our goal is to arrive or relate the engineering strain to true strain. So for that, let us try to arrive at an expression, or include the engineering strain in this term here. So the true strain is ln of L by L naught, and we can then add and subtract L naught in this term here. Now you can rearrange these terms, and you can write it as ln of L minus L naught plus L naught divided by L naught. And now you can further rearrange them by something like this, and this becomes 1, and this is nothing but, maybe I will highlight it in red, so this is nothing but your engineering strain. So this term here, L minus L naught by L naught, if you could recollect, even in this lecture we derived it. So this is nothing but your engineering strain. So that means the relation between the true strain and the engineering strain is something like this. So this is the relation between true strain and the engineering strain. So it is the logarithmic sum of engineering stress, engineering strain plus 1, which is nothing but the true strain. Now we can arrive at a similar expression for the engineering stress as well. So the engineering stress, or rather the relation between, we can arrive at the relation between the engineering stress and also the true stress. So we defined the true stress as the ratio of load to that of the instantaneous area. Now you can multiply and divide, or write this expression with respect to the original area. So this expression would look like something in this way. It will change to something like this, and now we have an expression for A naught by A. So it is A naught by A is nothing but L by L naught, or the extension ratio. So A naught by A is nothing but L by L naught, and therefore it is lambda. So and load by original area, or original cross-sectional area, is nothing but your engineering stress. So when you replace this 1 and 2 in 3, to substitute this 1 and 2 in 3, what you end up having is the true stress is nothing but engineering stress into L by L naught, and this L by L naught is nothing but the extension ratio. So the true stress is the product of engineering stress and the extension ratio. Now if you don't want to stick to this extension ratio, or the term that is related to the extension ratio, then you can further write this as, or you can, based on this expression, you can extend it to L plus L naught minus L naught by L naught. And then essentially what you are, what you would arrive at, because this term here is similar to the term that we saw here. So then, so this term here is similar to what we have here. So then ultimately the way to calculate true stress would be, so you now have an expression for the true stress that is dependent on the engineering stress and the engineering strain. Supposing you have then a curve that is exclusively based on engineering stress and the engineering strain, you have a curve something like this, then using this expression you can calculate the true stress values. And also by, from this expression here, you can also calculate the true strain value. So from these two expressions, maybe I will write it as say 4 and 5. So from equations 4 and 5, you can then translate the curve that is based on engineering stress versus engineering strain to true stress versus true strain. So we have now seen a way to relate the engineering stress and engineering strain. We have now derived two sets of expression that relate the engineering stress and engineering strain, and using that sets of expression you can translate, or you can replot a curve that you have exclusively based on engineering stress and engineering strain in terms of true stress and true strain. And of course you can do the vice versa as well. You can also calculate the engineering stress and engineering strain curve based on the true components of it. Now if you plot the true stress strain curve, I'll try to make it as straight as possible, good enough. So this true stress strain curve, the overall trend for this would look something like this. You have your elastic region, you would have it, and then you would have a continually increasing non-elastic or the plastic region. So you would have your, this would be your say elastic region, and from here onwards you would have your plastic region. And one significant difference is you will not have the ultimate tensile strength point, because the ultimate tensile strength or that point represents the necking behavior, and necking behavior means there is a change from the original cross-section area. And here we are considering not the original cross-section area but the instantaneous cross-sectional area, That means you won't have that point. You have removed that structural dependence of or that structural influence of the material on the stress strain curve by replacing the original cross sectional area with the instantaneous cross sectional area. And this is how a representative true stress and true strain curve would look like. And based on the equations 4 and 5, you would be able to plot the or translate the engineering stress strain curve to the true stress strain curves, and it will look like this. Now, if you want to express all of these evolution or all of these trend in terms of a single expression, you want to have an expression that is able to capture this particular behavior of the true stress strain curve. So there are ways you can do that numerically. You can calculate each and every point, you can measure each and every point and plot it. So that would be an experimental curve, or you could try to fit numerically the best possible curve that represents this particular representative behavior. So you have a behavior of the material without you have calculated the experimentally all the data points, and you have now a plot. You don't have a specific expression for it. You have calculated true stress and true strain from the experiment, and you have plotted a curve. Supposing that curve looks like this one here. So your experimental curve looks like this, but you don't have any specific numerical expression to denote this curve. Then the best way to do is numerically fitting the curve to plot different do it in the sense of a trial and error method. You plot, you write different expressions and see which one fits the best. You do it, you introduce a parabolic expression, you introduce a third order expression, all those things you do and see which one fits better. And it is observed that when you plot the behavior of the material in terms of true stress and true strain curve, and the best plot that fits to the experimental data, so the best curve that fits to the experimental data is an exponential curve, and that is written as or the order power law curve, and that is written as, so it is the best curve that fits is some sort of a power relation, and that is written as to the power n. So the best way you can fit an experimentally observed true stress strain curve is through this relation here, wherein you raise the observed or the true strain to a power n, and you begin fitting the curve, and for depending on the value of n, you will be able to arrive at a good agreement between the curves that you fit and the experimentally observed curves. So what you do is essentially you plot based on your experimental observation the true stress strain curve, and you try to plot or match different numerical curves to it. And it is observed that when you have a curve with this relation, wherein the x-axis, the term in the x-axis is related to the term on the y-axis through a power n, you get a decent agreement. So this red line is a fit. So when you have a numerical relation, something of this sort, wherein the true stress is related to the true strain through the power n, and this is often referred to as the power law relation. And when you fit a curve to the experimentally observed results, you are able to get a good agreement. And that is the reason why we can represent. When you have a good agreement with the experimental observation, then you can represent the behavior of the material in terms of the true stress and true strain in this relation. Now, to get rid of this proportionality constant here, replace it with A, and ultimately your expression looks something like this. So this expression here is what we can use to denote the true stress strain curve, and this we have achieved by fitting the different curves to the experimentally observed measures. And when we do that in using trial and error method, we see this particular form of a curve fits the true stress strain curve which was experimentally observed well, and then we just what we do is we replace the proportionality constant with A. Now this n term here, the need or the way the numerically fitted curve overlaps this experimentally observed curve, meaning the nature of this curve depends on this n term here. So when you vary the n term, you would see there is a change in the nature of this curve. For different n's, you will see a difference in the, for different n's, you will see a difference in the curve. Physically, the curve, what factor, if you relate, what factor governs this particular nature of the curve? If you could think about it, we saw it in moments before, it is nothing but the strain hardening. The behavior we see here, that is the increase in the amount of stress to add to the existing strain, is because of the strain hardening. And that is the reason why you get this typical trend here, an increasing trend here. After the elastic region, the increase in trend is because of the strain hardening. And this increase in trend is what we are trying to plot using this numerical expression here. And since this numerical expression is governed by the n term here, and physically this is governed by the strain hardening, the n is referred to as the strain hardening factor. Numerically, when you want to fit the curve, the n governs the nature of the curve. Physically, this curve is governed by strain hardening. Therefore, the n is the factor that governs or that relates the strain hardening in this numerical expression. So this factor introduces the strain hardening in this numerical expression, and that is the reason why we refer to it as the strain hardening factor. So in this lecture, what we have essentially done is we have now an expression to represent true stress strain curve, the overall expression to represent the true stress strain curve. It is a mathematical expression using which you can plot any or plot the true stress strain curve. We have now an expression for it. We have defined what a true stress and a true strain is, and we have also related the true stress to the engineering stress and true stress to engineering stress and engineering strain. So all this will help us to translate any engineering stress strain curve to true stress strain curve, or to calculate the specific value. And along with it, we have found that the component that brings the or introduces the strain hardening factor into the expression is the term n here, and therefore we refer to that as the strain hardening factor. So these are the different components or ways we can represent the behavior and the load that we impose on the material, or the mechanical condition that we impose on the material. And the behavior of the material can be expressed either in terms of the true stress strain curve or the engineering stress strain curve. So in the subsequent lectures, let us see what is the material behavior that causes this particular response of the material to the imposed condition. So far we have discussing graphically, we are talking about things graphically, we are representing the behavior of the material graphically. In the subsequent lectures, we will see what are the material factors that are responsible for this particular behavior of the material. So let's see ourselves in the next lecture. So goodbye.